thanks and welcome back to my channel. If you're new to this channel, you want to hit that subscribe button because this channel is full of tea, drama, and story times, and now crime stories. And I'm a chick from Brooklyn. Everybody loves a chick from Brooklyn, and that's on period. This is officially the first video for my crime documentary series, but I don't have a name for the series yet. So if you guys have any suggestions, please leave a comment down below and let me know some name ideas you guys have. And if you like someone's name idea, please thumbs up their comment because I plan to just pick the name with the most like. Now I know it took me forever to upload this video, but it was only because I wanted to do extensive research on this case. And believe it or not, I couldn't find anyone on YouTube that had already covered this case so I can get some information, a little bit of information. So I really had to go in deep and do all the research online. I deadass did not think it was gonna be that hard to find the information, only because this was a very big case in New York City. Now this is the case of Nixzmary Brown. Nixzmary Brown was also known as Nixy to family and friends, and she was born on July 18th, 1998 in Waterbury, Connecticut, to a Puerto Rican mother named Nixalis Santiago and a Pakistani father named Abdurrahman Mian. I don't really know if I'm pronouncing that right, but I guess the situation between Nixalis and Abdurrahman didn't work out, and he basically abandoned her and the baby before Nixzmary was even born. Like, he was a deadbeat from the jump. He didn't want no parts of that, but it's fine because Nixzmary moved on to meet a guy named Edward Brown, who basically stepped up to be the father figure to Nixzmary in her early life, and they were all in love and ended up having two kids of their own. But you know, things happen, life happens, and unfortunately that relationship didn't work out between Nixzmary and Edward, and she decided to just move back to Puerto Rico. So she is from Anguadilla, Puerto Rico. Maybe she just wanted to reset, figure out what she really wanted to do. You know, heartbreak be making you do a lot of things. She just probably wanted to take a step back and figure out what she was gonna do for her family now as a single mom. But in 2003, she decided, you know what, I don't really want to live in Puerto Rico, and came back to the United States. But this time she decided to move to New York City. Now when she moved to New York City, she ended up meeting a new man, and this man's name was Cesar Rodriguez, and they decided that they were in love as well and ended up getting married and moving to Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn, and having two more kids. Now if y'all know me, y'all know I go hard for Brooklyn. I'm a Brooklyn advocate, and Bed-Stuy is really not too far from the area that I lived in. Nixzmary and Cesar is just living this one happy family life, and Cesar didn't allow Nixzmary to work. Well, I don't know if he didn't allow her to work, but she was basically a housewife. She just stayed in the house with the five kids, and Cesar worked a job downtown Brooklyn being a security. He basically took care of her and his family. Keep in mind, at this point, it's a full house because she has Nixzmary, she has her two kids with Edward, and she has her two kids with Cesar. The kids did attend PS 256, and Nixzmary's classmates and teachers expressed that she was very like a ray of sunshine, very active, very playful, and smart. However, they can tell that there was definitely some things going on at home. On January 12, 2006, police received a call from a woman named Olvis Rivera. She was calling because her neighbor came to knock on her door and let her know that she needs police because her daughter had fell asleep in the bathtub and drowned. When police arrived to the home of Nixzmary and Cesar Rodriguez, they realized that even though they claimed that Nixzmary had drowned, she was completely dry, laying on the floor with pajama pants on and a t-shirt under her head. But she had visible bruises on her face, wrists, and ankles. So the police was really side-eyeing them like, what y'all said happened again? Nixzmary and Cesar basically said that Nixzmary had took a bath and forgot and fell asleep and drowned, and when they realized, they pulled her out the tub and called the police. But the police was not buying that because the math was really not mathing. If she had drowned in the tub, why was she in the room completely dressed? Now when police was realizing the math was not mathing in the situation, they decided to move on and arrest Nixzmary and Cesar because they just suspected abuse. The story that they was given just wasn't making sense, saying that their daughter had fell asleep and was in the tub for 3 hours but was bruised up, and the fact that they didn't even immediately call police and instead went to a neighbor for help, it just didn't make sense to the police, and they took Cesar in to question him. Now, when police decided to interview Cesar, he did express that he felt that Nixzmary was a troubled child and she did need disciplinary action. He said that she would fight with his sons, because remember, he had kids with Nixzmary as well. He claimed that she would fight with his son and just be rude to him and disrespectful, and sometimes he would bound her to a chair by her wrist and ankles just as a punishment. But he didn't see nothing wrong with doing this and didn't see it as abusive at all. He just thought that he was just disciplining Nixzmary. Now, a lot of us are very familiar with disciplinary actions, especially in Black and Caribbean households, getting a beating, getting a spanking. A lot of us grew up on that, so some people really don't deem it as something negative. However, this was definitely clear signs of abuse. On top of Nixzmary having bruises on her body, she was also 36 pounds at the time of her death, which is underweight for a 7-year-old. The average 7-year-old weighs about 50 pounds. So not only was she being abused, she was also being neglected. Now, the reason why this case made such a big impact in New York City is because the ACS, which is like Child Protective Services in New York City, played a big role in Nixzmary's death. Now, there were multiple reports of abuse being made by Nixzmary's teachers, principals, counselors about how her and her siblings were missing hella school. At one point, Nixzmary missed 46 days of school. Now, one thing about missing school in New York City, you are going to get an ACS case. Everybody knows that. Nixzmary would show up to school with bruises and marks and signs of physical abuse on her, and the teachers would report this to the school guidance counselors, social workers, who would then call the abuse hotline. In one instance, on May 16, 2005, Nixzmary's guidance counselor at school had called in and made a report that Nixzmary had missed 45 days of school. 45 days of school is a lot of days to be missing from school. In this instance, it was also reported that Nixzmary was coming to school with a burned hand, and her brother was going around school telling everybody that she burned her hand on the stove. So the teachers was very concerned, because listen, what's going on at home that nobody's paying attention to you to see that you're burning your hand on the stove? Not only was he going around saying that she burned her hand on the stove, he also said that she fell off the bed one night and hit her head. And the teachers really thought like this needed to be investigated, because it was true. Nixzmary was showing up to school with bruises and scars, and she wasn't really explaining what had happened to her. Now, this is elementary school, don't get me wrong. So it's not uncommon for kids to come to school maybe with a cut or something from over the weekend, because kids are clumsy as shit. Everybody knows that. But this was a constant occurrence. On top of her missing school, when she did come to school, she always had a mark on her, and that was something that was a big rager red flag. So on May 16th, a ACS caseworker attempted to make a home visit, but it was unsuccessful. They was knocking on the door, nobody was answering the door, so they just left. On May 18th, 2005, the caseworker was able to go in the house and actually interview the family. And when she asked Nixzmary about the burn on her hand, Nixzmary said that she got it on a radiator. And she was just like, okay, keep in mind, this is in May. Ain't no fucking radiator on in May. But she didn't even question it one bit. When she asked Nixzmary if she had fell and hit her head, she didn't even know what she was talking about. Nixzmary was like, no, like what? I didn't fall and hit my head on anything. I burned my hand on the radiator. And then the caseworker went on to the brother, who was basically telling all the teachers that Nixzmary burned her hand on the stove, and was like, oh, what happened to her hand? And the brother is like, oh yeah, she burned it on a radiator. And instead of the caseworker finding this to be odd, because it's like, okay, but you was at school telling everyone it was the stove, but here you're changing it to match your sister's, she just rolled it off as, okay, she said she burned her hand on the radiator, I'm just gonna just take that for it. She didn't even press it too hard. Keep in mind, this is May. It was also noted that Nixilis said the reason why Nixzmary was missing all this school is because she was pregnant, and then she had 5 kids, and her husband worked full time, and sometimes she was just overwhelmed and wasn't able to take her kid to school. I felt like that was just another red flag, because bro, if you are incapable, if you are already overwhelmed by having 5 kids, why are you pregnant with another one? And you're literally a housewife. Like, you don't work, your husband works. The least you can do is take your children to school. So I don't know why that was the excuse that she used and why the caseworker thought that was a good explanation, but they came to the agreement that she will close the case, that it was important that Nixzmary would be attending school. And Nixilis told the caseworker, like, yeah, I'm gonna work on it. Like, listen, I'm gonna try to get her to school every day. And from there, the caseworker thought everything would be fine. I also forgot to mention, it was also notated that Nixzmary was severely underweight at this time as well. And when the caseworker questioned Nixilis and Cesar about Nixzmary's weight, they claimed that she didn't like to eat. Like, she literally had an eating disorder. They said they tried to feed her all the time. She didn't want to eat. She chose not to eat. And that they were seeking medical advice from her physician on what they can do to make her eat more. And the caseworker just took that in and believed it because like I said, she checked the fridge, she checked the cabinets, there was food there. And even though they didn't prove that they sought medical help or anything from a doctor or physician that was saying that Nixzmary had an eating disorder, the caseworker just charged it and believed what Cesar and Nixilis was telling them, that Nixzmary was underweight because she just didn't want to eat. So time went on and the abuse continued, and on December 1st, 2005, it was reported again to the ACS. They believed that Nixzmary was being abused at home, and they didn't believe it was only Nixzmary being abused. They also thought that Nixilis might have been being abused. And the reason they believed that Nixzmary was still being abused at the time is because she came to school with a black eye and a cut on her head. On top of that, she was still missing school. Even though Nixilis promised the ACS worker she would try her best to start getting her to school, she was still missing school. So this time, the ACS caseworker came to the school to interview Nixzmary and her siblings. Now, after the caseworker interviewed Nixzmary at school, they determined that the bruises that she had on her body this time was not from abuse and that she had fell on a piece of wood. The reason why they believe that this was true is because when they interviewed her siblings as well, they all had the same story. Nixzmary fell on a piece of wood. But the ACS worker still didn't question, where was the wood from? How did she fall on the wood? Why did she fall on the wood? How did falling on wood give her a black eye? So many questions. They were just like, okay, she fell on wood. Like, bro, I just feel like, I don't know if the ACS workers were overworked, they had too many cases, but I just feel like they was missing all the red flags. It's kind of sad. You are responsible for the lives of children. People depend on you to take children out of traumatic situations, and because you're overwhelmed with work, you're ready to open and close shut. It's been 2 occasions where this child has constantly missed school, and when she shows up to school, she's all fucked up. And you think that it's just a coincidence that she's just at home all these days, all these weeks, not in school, just falling on stuff, getting hurt by stuff. Even if that was the case, that is still a sign of neglect. Where is the parent when she's hurting herself, and why is there no concern? Like, I don't understand. After interviewing Nixzmary and her siblings at school, the ACS worker went to the home of the Rodriguez family and interviewed Cesar, and he also said, yes, Nixzmary fell on a piece of wood and she had to get stitches, and he took her to Woodhull Hospital. Now, the right thing to do in the situation would be for the ACS worker to ask for them to provide proof of the hospital visits and just follow up with the information based on the hospital record, just to make sure that the scar that Nixzmary had was consistent with somebody falling on a piece of wood. But once again, the ACS worker did not put that work in. They just took the word of Cesar and was like, okay, she fell, you took her to the hospital. Another weird thing about the situation is when they went to interview the family at the house, while they were speaking to Nixzmary, she would speak to her children in front of the ACS workers in Spanish. And the ACS worker that was interviewing at the time was not a fluent Spanish speaker, so she didn't know what Nixzmary was telling her children in the middle of the interview, which is super inappropriate because this whole time she could be telling them what to say and you don't even understand. You don't see that as a red flag. She could be telling them, yo, say this, say that, and you just sitting there just listening to the English version of it. Now, when the ACS worker was asking Nixzmary what happened to Nixzmary's face, she said that at the time that Nixzmary fell on a piece of wood, she wasn't even around. Because at this time she was having a miscarriage. She even offered to show the ACS worker the fetus that she saved in a jar. But I really don't know if this was a thing at the time to have your fetus when you lost your baby. But yeah, Nixzmary was like, on some, you want to see, like, I dead had a miscarriage, trying to show the ACS worker her fetus in the jar. Now, out of all the situations that happened at this time and all of the signs of abuse, the only issue the ACS worker found with the situation was the fact that Nixzmary had her fetus in a jar ready to show. The ACS worker noted that she think that Nixzmary needs to seek some mental health help because she don't know why she over here with a fetus in a jar trying to show it off. That was the only thing that weirded her out. Not Nixzmary having stitches on her face, a burn on her hand, and missing days of school. She just thought it was weird that her mother wanted to show her fetus in a jar. Now, after this interview this day, there were several other follow-up visits that the ACS workers were trying to conduct between December 8th and 10th. The ACS workers was continuously calling Cesar and Nixzmary, trying to get in contact with them and trying to come to the home and visit to see if everything is fine so they could close out the case. But after several attempts, they weren't getting any responses. They would go knock at the door, nobody would answer, and they were calling the phone so much till the phones were disconnected. Now, this is another red flag that the ACS worker missed, because it's like, if you're not doing anything suspicious and if you are not abusing your child and if everything is what you say it is, why are you ducking me? Just do the interviews and get it over with. Let me follow up, make sure things is good, and get it over with. But the ACS worker continued to show up to the house until she showed up on January 12th. And when she showed up on January 12th, she realized it was a whole bunch of police and EMTs there. And when she walked in the door, she had been informed that Nixzmary Brown was now deceased. And when she asked about details from the EMT workers, they expressed to the ACS worker that when they found Nixzmary in the condition, she was very, very, very tiny and had several bruises on her body, and that it was obvious that she was abused. I can only imagine how the ACS worker felt at this time. I'm sure she felt like, damn, this whole time I could have been resolving this issue. I could have gotten this child out of this situation, and I just disregarded everything, all the red flags, and now look at this situation. Like I've mentioned earlier in this video, when Nixzmary Brown was found, she had on pajama pants and a t-shirt under her head and completely dry, although her parents had said that she had drowned in the tub after falling asleep and was in the tub for 3 hours. The police, everyone believed that that was literal bullshit, and after interviewing Cesar, they realized, based on the information that he said, that this had to be a result of abuse from Cesar. So him and Nixzmary was arrested. Initially, when they were arrested, they both were facing second degree murder charges, but they did trial separately, and when Cesar went to trial, he was only facing second degree manslaughter. So because Nixzmary and Cesar were trialed separately, their lawyers were trying to play the blame game. On January 16, 2008, Cesar's trial began, and the prosecution's focus point was these photos that were taken of Nixzmary at the scene, of her body in the condition it was, her laying there underweight for a 7-year-old with bruises. And they wanted it to be known to the jury that Cesar and Nixzmary didn't try with any urgency to get Nixzmary any help while she was dying on the ground. They didn't try to help her in any way. They didn't try to call police right away. They literally let her lay there and moan and groan in pain until she died. And Cesar's defense was just plainly that he did not beat her to death and that he just disciplined her from time to time. He claimed to have not been the one to actually kill her, and that was his defense. Now, as the trial went on, more facts of abuse came out, and this is where I kind of was getting more and more sick about the details of this case. As the trial went on, photos of Cesar and Nixzmary's apartment was portrayed in the case, and they showed a room that had the chair and the ties that Cesar used to tie Nixzmary to a chair, and it also had a litter box in it. And the prosecution claimed that this was a litter box that they actually made Nixzmary use, and that they didn't allow her to eat any of the food in the house, and Cesar felt that everything in the house was only for his sons. Like, she couldn't eat the snacks, the food, anything he bought for his sons, she could not have it, and he literally treated her like an animal. On top of the photos of Nixzmary and the photos of the crime scene and inside of the apartment, the prosecution also presented the fact that there was blood all over this torture room, as they called it in the case, where they held Nixzmary with the litter box, the wire, and the chair. There was residue of blood, and it was also residue of blood on Cesar's jeans that he was wearing on the day that Nixzmary died. They also had two witnesses take the stand, one of them being the neighbor that made the 911 call, and she expressed that the day that Nixzmary knocked on her door, like I said before, Nixzmary didn't seem to express any type of emotion, even though her daughter was dead downstairs. And she also realized that when she finally made the call to police, that all of a sudden Nixzmary was crying hysterically. She also said that when she went to the apartment to see Nixzmary, she was confused because Nixzmary told her Nixzmary drowned, but Nixzmary was dry with clothes on in her bedroom floor, so it really wasn't making sense. They also had Nixzmary's grandmother, Maria Gonzalez, which was Nixzmary's mom, testify as well, and she wasn't really saying much to help the case. I think her main concern was to give information because she was trying to sue the city for neglect, $150 million lawsuit for neglect in regards to Nixzmary Brown's death, which is so weird to me. I just looked at this as she took an opportunity, because in all the research I did, I didn't find any information about Maria suspecting that Nixzmary was abused or stepping in as a grandmother to remove her from that situation. However, as soon as she died, the first thing you want to do is sue the city for neglect and testify just to make your lawsuit hold more weight. After three long months, on March 18th, 2008, Cesar Rodriguez was found guilty of second-degree manslaughter. And on April 3rd, 2008, Cesar Rodriguez was sentenced to 26 to 29 years in prison for the death of Nixzmary Brown. I honestly felt like he deserved way, 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 way more time in jail. He could have honestly did life. Like, he really did not deserve to walk or see the outside world again for what he did, and the extent of the abuse that he did to Nixzmary Brown, especially with all the information that was brought up in the trial. And if you want, you can go ahead and try to Google those crime scene photos. It is on the internet. It is very graphic. Through this whole time and had no one she can turn to for help, I feel like he should have gotten a life sentence, honestly. Now, after his trial was over, they had to move on to Nixzmary's trial. And Nixzmary's trial began on September 15th, 2008. And her defense team took the, she was a victim of abuse as well. That was their stance on the situation. And that because she wasn't physically involved in the death of Nixzmary Brown, that she was just as innocent. The defense also tried to say that the only thing that Nixzmary was guilty of was not stopping all the abuse, but she was just too scared. They even went as far as saying that the reason why she had a miscarriage is because Cesar repeatedly put his hands on her until she lost the baby. The prosecution standpoint was mainly like, listen, all of these things were happening, you didn't try at least to stop the death of your own daughter. They made it clear that Nixzmary was screaming, crying throughout the whole duration of the beating that took her life. Nixzmary's lawyer claimed that she didn't even hear when the attack was happening because Nixzmary's mouth was duct taped, so she didn't hear her screaming or calling for her. Like, girl, what? If your husband is not around and your husband is always abusing your daughter and you don't see your daughter, why the hell, like, y'all are all in the same apartment. You telling me you don't know what's happening in the next room? You're not thinking for a second he may be beating your daughter? During this trial, it was also mentioned that the reason why Cesar gave Nixzmary this beating is because she took a yogurt out of the fridge that belonged to one of his sons. Now, the fact that Cesar even beat Nixzmary for over a couple of yogurt just proves that they were depriving her from food and stuff like that, and letting her brothers eat and do all this stuff, and she couldn't even have a yogurt. It also was said that Nixzmary was messing around with one of his printers and stuffed it with something that caused it to jam and break. And that was the thing that really upset Caesar the most. During the trial, it was proven that on the evening that Nixzmary Brown died, Caesar was so upset that she broke his printer that she ran cold water and doused her head under the cold water, then took her from the bathroom into the room where he beat her to death. So for Nixzmary to say all of this happened and she did not know because Nixzmary's mouth was duct taped did not make sense. Nixzmary's lawyer even begged the jury to only find her guilty of negligent homicide, which only had a maximum of 4 years. So she was really not trying to do no time for this. And that was sick to me. Like, this is just as much your fault as it is his. And I feel like it's even more your fault that this situation even happened because you let it get to this point. But on November 12, 2008, Nixzmary Santiago Rodriguez was found guilty of manslaughter in the second degree. And when she was sentenced, unlike Cesar Rodriguez, she was sentenced to 43 years because the judge believed that she was the main reason all of this happened. Pretty much how I feel. Like, the judge basically felt that if she stepped in as a mother, it would have never got this far to the point where Nixzmary would have been dead. And I agree 100%. Some people felt like the sentencing was harsh, being that Cesar only got 29 years and he was the one who physically killed Nixzmary. But a lot of people thought that 43 years was fair. I honestly felt like that was a fair sentence, but I also wanted to see Caesar do more time. Nixzmary also felt that the sentence was unfair because she felt like she was a victim herself. There was also an order of protection placed on Nixzmary against her kids, so she wouldn't be able to see or come in contact with them after this situation. In 2009, the Nixzmary Brown law was passed, and this law just basically boosted time for people who purposely tortured or tried to kill kids. This was a very important law in New York because there at the time there was a lot of child abuse cases going on, and the ACS workers who were involved in these cases of Nixzmary Brown's household did suffer some consequences for disregarding all the signs of abuse in the household. Now, in 2017, Abdul Rahman Mayan, which was Nixzmary Brown's biological father, actually tried to sue the city in regards to neglect in the death of Nixzmary Brown, and he actually settled for $750,000. This guy definitely is a sick ass individual, and I don't even know how they allowed that to happen. This guy was never ever in Nixzmary's life. He basically abandoned Nixzmary when she was pregnant, and he even said it himself that his first time ever seeing Nixzmary was in the casket at her funeral. Yet they rewarded him $750,000 in his daughter's death. There was some type of legal reasons why, is because he was the biological father. He was somewhat entitled to that money, but I still feel like it was sick because if he had stepped up as a father, Nixzmary's life could have possibly been different. If she had someone there to protect and defend her against Caesar, a man at that, her biological father, she probably would have been alive. But instead, he used this as an opportunity to cash out on his daughter's death. Fucking sick. I also feel like maybe him neglecting Nixzmary before she was even born made Nixzmary feel some type of way towards Nixzmary, and is the reason why she even allowed all this abuse to occur. That's the first thing that came into my mind, because I've heard of situations like that where mothers hate the fathers of the child and they just take it out on the child. It's just fucking sick because she didn't ask to be here. You need to hold that man accountable and not your daughter. I don't know if that is what happened, but I feel like that could have been one of the reasons why Nixzmary was treated so terribly. I don't know what you guys think. Let me know your feelings about this case. What did you think? Do you think that Nixzmary's sentencing was a little bit too much and Caesar was a little too light? And how do you feel about Nixzmary's biological father being able to get $750,000 in regards to her death when that nigga never was in her life? Like, that was the sickest shit of this whole story. But thank you for watching this video, and if you like this video and you want more videos, tell a friend to hit that subscribe button, because we on the road to 50k, and from 50k is 51k, 52k, 53k, and from there it's up and it's stuck.